Now we will assume these four assumptions. So from the first assumption, G is a compact connectly group. So in the next property, I will introduce some basic facts of the compact connectly group. Compact connectly group. So I will start from the this theorem. Actually, this is a very big theorem. Maybe the first person who approved this is an Borel de Siebenthaler, I think. Okay, so now G is a compact connectly group. Then there is a finite covering. G tilde. G tilde is also a compact connect, not connected. It's an, a compactly group such that it's also a connectedly group. I'm sorry. So G tilde is decomposes onto like this. G1 times G sum m times TL. And here, this, okay, I will explain the theorem. Here, this TL is, of course, this is an L-dimensional torus. T1, L, it's an L-dimensional torus. And each GI, this is called an compact connected simple Lie group. Compact connected. And by using the classical Lie theory, we've already known the classification of the such kind of compact connectly simple Lie group. So this is classified by classified as the first one is a classical type. Each GI that is. Called each GI is called a type AN or type BN or type CN or type DN or an or exceptional type. That is, it's called an G2 F4 and E6 E7, E8. So it means that up to finite covering, this G is already classified. Okay, so G is just decomposed into the simple Lie group times some torus action, torus. So here, what is classical type and exceptional type? I will explain a little bit about it. So for example, actually this is determined up to finite cover. That is, this is classified by the Lie algebra. So if when G is AN, in this case, for example, G is SUN plus 1. Actually, this is for example. It might be OK by divided by some finite groups. Okay. And if G is BN, one of them is G is SO2N plus 1. Actually, this is not a simply connected. So if we want to take a simply connected, we need to take a double cover in this case. This is called spin 2N plus 1. And anyway, this is one of the example. This is just an example of the such kind of lead,
lead types.
If this is Cn, then G is one of them is G is C, Spn. Spn is defined by the some quaternionic group. And Dn is called an, one of the examples of the Dn is an SO2n. So such kind of groups is an example of the classical types. Okay. So up to finite quotient or finite covering, we can take G as an SU or SO or SP as a classical type. And what is an exceptional type? Actually, an exceptional type is a little bit complicated to define it. So if you are interested in G's or E6, E7, or E8, in this case, please refer to, for example, the Ichiro Yokota's book. Actually, this is written by Japanese, but recently it's translated into the English and uploaded in the archive. So this is called an exceptional Lie group.
Archive?
Yes, it's on the archive.
How can you search
it? Oh, okay. The name or I will write an archive number. Exceptional Lie group. It's on the archive. 0902. Actually, it's not recent. It's on 5 years ago. 0902. 0431. So from this fact, we've already know that what kind of compact conical Lie group appears as its Lie group. We completely know that. But to compute this kind of equivalent cohomology is a different story. And in order to think about equivalent cohomology or cohomology of the PC or some equivalent cohomology, then to take a maximal torus is a very fundamental technique. So let Tn be a maximal torus. Torus of G. Yeah, actually, I denoted some index in an, bn, cn, dn. This means that this is a dimension of the maximal torus of each types. So that means that exceptional types, this maximal torus is determined. This dimension is determined. So for example, G2 case, its maximal torus is two-dimensional. And F4 case, its maximal torus is four-dimensional, something like this. Okay, in general, we can take n-dimensional maximal torus. So that means that is, this is a maximal compact abelian group, compact connected abelian group. Actually, S1, Tn is an isomorphic to the n times S1, so it's an abelian group. And one more fundamental notions of the compact Lie group. This is often denoted by W of G, or W sub G. This is defined by the normalizer of the maximal torus of G divided by this T. And this is called an Y group. And this gives a very important role to compute some of the equivalent cohomology or cohomology of the G actions. So for example, let's take G equal SU n plus 1. So this is a classical type, so-called type AN. In this case, its maximal torus is isomorphic to, actually this is not unique, but up to conjugate it's unique. This can be taken as the diagonal matrix. Okay? So SUN plus 1 is an n plus 1 matrix. And its diagonal is on a TN as a exactly a maxima torus. And then this Weyl group is can be computed by a normalize of TN divided by TN. And actually this is the same with an symmetric group of n plus 1. This is an n plus 1 symmetric group. So for example, n equal 1, in this case, we can easy to compute it. It's on WS, actually it is NT1 SU2. It's nothing but this kind of group. Maybe you can easy to compute it in SU2. And it's quotient by the T1. It's isomorphic to Z over two Z. Okay, so one of them is an identity, other is an compatible two elements. Okay, so this is nothing but S2. Okay. Okay, this is the Weyl group. And by using Weyl group, we can, for example, we can compute the following cohomologies. And this lemma gives an, some general facts of the cohomology ring of the H sub G. So this is the lemma. So let's take if so G is a compact connected Lie group, this is an assumption, axon M freely. So in this case, its quotient must be a nice space. Of course, in this case, it's a maximal torus, axon M free. But then, this cohomology, this is an cohomology of the M over G, is nothing but the cohomology divided by T with an a Weyl group fixed point, okay? Weyl group invariant part. This is a lemma. Maybe I need to explain about this part. What does this mean? This means that now M over T has a Weyl group action. Because G, now G axon M, so it means that NGT over T axon M over T. So this is nothing but the Weyl group. And this action induces a Weyl group action on a cohomology of M over T. And this means that the set of the fixed point. Actually, this is a subalgebra of the H sub ET. Any question? So this lemma is very important, and okay. Okay. Sketch on proof. So the one of the point is to think about this fiber bundle. Actually, now G axon M freely and T axon M freely, this situation is often appeared. So it means that now there is an M over G here. And actually, T also axon M freely. So in this case, it's one point pullback is nothing but G over T. Okay? So let's consider this fiber bundle. And in this case, this fiber bundle has this kind of splitting. So what is this? Okay, let's say here is an now NGT is an okay. So now we have three free actions, G, N, G, T, and T. So now there's a fiber bundle structure by using G and T. And we can also get some fiber bundle structure by using N, G, T action. So let's denote by it. N, G, T, the first one is this fiber bundle. Actually, in this case, it's fiber is nothing but N, G, T over T. So it's a wild group. So this fiber bundle, whose fiber is wild group. And also there is fiber bundle here. And this fiber is G over NGT. And one of the key points is to prove this is a QR cyclic. So it means that, namely, this cohomology, of course we are thinking about the Q coefficient. This is isomorphic to the point. So can you believe this? Actually, for example. So let's look at the previous example. For example, this one. So in this case, so now we want to prove SU2 divided by NSU, I said it's a G. GT1 is a QR cycle or not. Actually, this is maybe regarded as something like this. Now, as you know, SU2 is an homeomorphic to the S3, okay, three dimensional sphere. And now this NGT1 is just an S1 times. Actually, this is kind of a semi-direct product of this S2. So it means that this is nothing but S3 divided by S1, also divided by some S2. I should say Z over Z2. 2Z. Okay, something like this. And now S3 over S1 is an S2. And this Z2 action is a free action, nothing but a free action. So it means that this becomes RP2. And RP2 is a QR cyclic. So this is, in general, this is true. OK, so please believe this, OK? So because this is a QR cyclic, this is nothing but a one point. Its cohomology is nothing but a one point. So it means that these two cohomology rings are same. Okay? So therefore, let's start M over G and let's start M over NGT. Are isomorphic, okay? So then we can use this fiber bundle structure because now M over T to N over NGT. Actually, this is a finite covering with a WG action. Of course, this is a regular covering. It's a regular covering. A regular means this finite group acts on transitively on a finite point on a finite fiber, regular covering. So we can use this fact. This cohomology, this cohomology M over T, I'm sorry, this cohomology is nothing but cohomology of this space with WC invariant part. Okay. So if you want to know the proof of this, this is maybe the Breton's book is a good book. It's an introduction to. Compact transformation groups. Actually, we need to use some transfer to prove this. Okay, so actually, this statement gives an statement which we want. Because this H star NG over T is not but, is nothing but H star M over G. And we want to prove it is H star M over G is isomorphic to H star M over T with an dual group invariant. So this is done. Okay. Okay, so this lemma is a very general lemma, but we can get many interesting results from this lemma. For example, actually this corollary states the answer of the previous natural question. The natural question was on H star BG, how to compute the H star BG. Actually, now this H star BG is nothing but H star BT with Y group invariant part. Okay? The invariant part of the Y group action. Okay? Because G acts on EG freely. And of course, this torus is a maximal torus, and torus axon is freely. So we can use this lemma in this situation. Okay. Now this EG is an M in the lemma. And also we know this kind of things for TN. So let's think about this kind of compact connected Lie group, Lie subgroup of G. So this is called an maximal rank subgroup of G. So now Tn is on the maximal torus of G. So Tn is also on the maximal torus of H. Okay. In this case, now we also have this kind of identity. Now the cohomology of the G over H is nothing but the cohomology of G over T. With WG. Okay? No, it's WH. Sorry. Because in this case, H acts on G freely. And T also acts on G freely. So in the previous lemma, we will take G as an M. Then we can get this corollary. So actually, the important part is this part. To compute the H star BC, it is enough to compute the H star BT and its wild group action. Okay. So this corollary also said that the T action is very important to consider all of the compact connected Lie group action. And actually, this kind of things is known. This is a final property of this section. Now, this H star PTN, as I said before, this is just an CP infinity. infinity to the n. And now this is nothing but n times tensor of the h star cp infinity. And h star cp infinity is nothing but an this one. It's a polynomial ring. So this cohomology of the BTN is nothing but a polynomial ring with n values. Okay? And moreover, this degree is 2. Okay? So there is no odd degree part in H star BTN. Yeah, actually, this is also known from the by using the spectral sequence on the fiber bundle of the S infinity, whose fiber is S1 and whose base space CP infinity. Okay. Okay. So this is finished for section 2. So until now, do you have any questions?
So this bidirection, 6.7 bidirection.
And this BT. Mm-hmm. A fixed point set.
Yeah.
For example, yeah. So, okay. Yeah. Let me show.
AN or
BN or. Okay. Actually, to give all of them is very difficult.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, actually.
Usually AN is.
Yeah, AN is enough, I think. So, all right, let's think, for example. As I said, the wild group of the SU n plus 1 is an n plus 1 symmetry, okay? So in this case, I'm sorry, this I should say un plus 1 is better. So please change to the un plus 1. This is this wild group is also same as an sn plus 1, okay? So in this case, h star b un plus 1 is nothing but using the previous corollary. This is an h star b t, in this case, tn plus 1. So I should say, yes, this is a un. It changes to the un. This is better. Un. Un is a wg action. So in this case, it's an sn. Okay? So this is nothing but we already know this is a polynomial ring. And it's SN invariant part. And actually, this is well known. For example, please see at the Milner-Stashev or something. This is isomorphic to this kind of polynomials. E2ENU. Here, this EI is called an i-th symmetric polynomial. Sorry, this is. EIU, this means I abbreviate this U1 to UN by U. This U means U1 to UN. And this is an i-th symmetric polynomial. This means that you can product exactly I entries of the U1 to the UN and a summation of all of the such kind of things, such kind of product. So that is this R1 to the Rn, Ri, is taken from the 1 to the n. Okay, so this is called an isosymmetric. Ice elementary symmetric product, a polynomial. So, for example, the easiest case is an E1. In this case, all of the entries are just I. So it is a summation of the U1 to the UN. And our second part is, this is an this I is 2. So all of the a term is just an, 2 elements. So it's just U1, U2 plus U1, U3 plus blah, 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 plus U1, UN plus U2, U3 plus blah, blah, blah. And finally, it becomes UN minus 1, UN, something like this. Okay? Okay.
I also mean she's compact and connected.
Yes, that's right.
So, I'm sorry, but where the condition compactness and connectedness is necessary for this statement?
Compactness and connectedness.
Like a
cyclic. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. So please wait. Now to think about the cohomology, G is compact is okay. Because as I said before, it's an deformation retract on the compact part. And connectedness we need is an yes, maybe it doesn't hold, I think. Yes, that's right. Okay, so do you have any other questions? Okay, so let's continue the next section. Last one. No. So this is one of the main topic of this series of the lectures, computation of equivalent cohomology of G over T. So as I said, to think about G actions, T actions are very important. And moreover, all of the homogeneous space, this kind of space is called a homogeneous space, is can be computed by using the homogeneous space divided by these torus actions. So this G over T, to think about this G over T is an essential to think this kind of homogeneous cohomology of the homogeneous space. Okay? And now G is, as I said, is a compact connected Lie group. And T is maximal torus. And this G over T has some name. This is called a Flagg manifold. So for example, you already know the other definition of the Flagg manifold. Actually, usually it's called a full Flagg manifold and denoted by FLCN. This is the set of the flags of the CN. Here this this VI is complex dimension I. So this is a sequence of the subspaces of the CN from the 0 and 1 dimensional, 2 dimensional, blah, 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 and minus 1 dimensional and CN. And the set of this sequence is called a Flagg. So the set of all Flaggs is called a Flagg manifold. Okay? So this is a very important manifold which appears everywhere in the mathematics. And actually this has an, this kind of structures. Because now UN acts on CN, actually this action is transitively. And moreover, this isotropy subgroup on, for example, the standard flag, for example, 0 and E1 coordinate and E2, E1 plus E2 coordinate and E1, E2, EC coordinate or something. This is called the standard flag. So considering the isotropy subgroup of the standard flag, then this is nothing but the torus, maximal torus. So this full Flach manifold is can be represented by this kind of homogeneous space. So actually, this is a topological counterpart of this Flach manifold. Actually, this is a kind of the complex geometric definition or algebraic geometric definitions, and this is kind of the topological definitions. So this is called the Flach manifold. Actually, there is another Flach manifold type C or type B or type D or type E or something. All of them can be denoted by this way. Okay. So we call this G over T a Flach manifold. Okay, so let's think about the torus action on this Flach manifold. Actually, there is a natural torus action on the Flach manifold because this Tn, actually, we may think this Tn action forms the right-hand side. So there is a left Tn action. Actually, G is not the abelian, not the abel group. So this T action has some meanings. So we define this Tn action on the G over T by the left-hand side. From left, defined by is defined by the left multiplication. Namely, if you take the element T from the torus, and we can denote some of the element G over T by G, this kind of subscript. This is denoted by GT. This is nothing but TG. So this is a torus action on a G over T. And I would like to compute what is this equivalent cohomology. Okay, it's a rational coefficient. So first, let me show you an answer of this question. Actually, this is proved by Borel. The equivalent cohomology of the G over T action is isomorphic to the next ring. This is a polynomial ring which is generated by x1 to the xn and y1 tilde to the yn tilde divided by some ideal. And here this ideal is generated by the sum of the polynomial defined by ex minus ey tilde. Ex means this is just a sum of the polynomial whose variable is x1 to xn, and ey tilde is whose variable is e1 tilde to en tilde. And this e is some polynomial which is taken from the invariant part of the wild group action. Okay. So actually, this is a theorem by Borel. Here, it's degree of xi and degree of yi tilde. Two. So I will give some of the example of this theorem. Before that, I would like to remark that now, as I said, there is a finite covering over G, and this can be denoted by G1 times Gm times TL. Okay, so in this case, it's G over T is nothing but
N, or you are using N.
N, which one? N is an, this part.
Maximum.
Yes.
So G tilde, you're
yeah. Yeah, G1 to the Gm.
No, TL.
TL, yes, that's right.
Is TL or TN?
TL.
Not maximum torus?
Actually, there is another torus here to here.
Oh,
and
okay.
These products are maximum torus.
Okay.
Okay, so TL is on TM.
Oh, sure, sure, yeah.
Okay, so in this case, this is nothing but a product of the this Frank manifold. So Frank manifold for each coordinates. Okay. And also in this case, while group is nothing but the product of the while group for each simple regroup. So therefore, using a Knuth formula, it is essentially to prove a simple part. So T1. It's enough. This is a Knuth formula. But anyway, this formula gives an, a very general formula, even if for these cases. So let's compute the equivalent cohomology of the Frank manifold for the more complete concrete case. So let's look at by using the example for n equal 1 case. So in this case, this is known that n equal 1 is a maximal maximal torus. A maximal torus is just an one dimensional. In this case, G is an almost SU2. If it's simply connected. Okay. And T is nothing but it's T1. It's just a circular action. And in this case, its Frank manifold is a well-known well-known manifold. SU2 over T1. This is already denoted by S3 divided by S1. And this is CP1. So another way to denote it is an S2. This is a homeomorphic to the two-dimensional sphere. And moreover, in this case, while group is, as I said before, it's an S2. And the problem is how to act S2 on the polynomial ring. And in this case, it's an H star BG must be H star BT1 with this while group action. And H star BT1 is nothing but a polynomial ring generated by the one element. And it's an S2 invariant part. So actually, in this case, this is equal to the polynomial ring generated by U squared. So let's say S2 denoted by 1 and sigma. And in this case, sigma acts on U to the minus U. So U squared is an invariant under the sigma action. Okay? So let's compute the equivalent cohomology in this case. So therefore, by the Polaroid theorem, we have this kind of things. T1 star SU2 divided by T1 is, now it's n equal 1, so there are two generators, x1, y1 tilde. We will denote it an x and y tilde. X and y tilde. And it's ideal, it's generated by some of the polynomial, which is invariant under the wild group. So in this case, it's polynomial just on u squared. Okay? So u squared is now ex is an x squared, and ey tilde is y tilde squared in this case. So in this case, it's just on this one. Okay? So this is a formula of the equivalent cohomology of the n equal 1 case. And actually, I'm sorry. Okay.
It's not quite relevant to your talk, but is there any reason to you put the tilde over one?
Yes. I will denote it later.
Okay.
Yes. Maybe day after tomorrow, I think. Yeah, actually, this gives a lift from some of the chunkers from the ordinary Frank manifold, the chunkers of the ordinary Frank manifold. Okay. I would like to talk about it. Actually, this is nothing but the equivalent cohomology of the CP1. Now, let's put x equals 0. Then there is some of the this kind of bijective surjective map, okay? Because x is just 0, then minus y squared is an ideal. It's the same as an y squared. And actually, maybe you know that this is a cohomology, nothing but the cohomology ring of the CP1. So by this way, we can obtain the cohomology ring of the CP1 from the equivalent cohomology. Okay? And I think I need to give this remark because there are many toric topologies in this room. Okay.
So the x part is coming from BT.
Yeah, that's right.
BT.
Yes, BT1.
And the y is sort of a lift of.
Yes, that's right. Lift of the CP1. Actually, maybe almost many people know about the toric geometry. So let's compare with the formula obtained by a toric geometry. Actually, we can also get some of the formula from the toric geometry. Actually, this T1 action CP1 may be regarded as a toric manifold. So in a toric manifold, the toric topology or toric geometric person knows about how to compute the equivalent cohomology. So let's apply it. Then we can obtain this kind of formula. So toric geometry person uses tau 1. And by using the toric geometry, then we can obtain this kind of formula. Yeah, I will talk about toric geometry in the final day. Anyway, so by using this theory, we can obtain this kind of formula. Actually, there is a relation between these two formulas. Now, we can have this kind of map from here to here. So let's tau 1 goes to x plus y tilde, and tau 2 goes to x minus y tilde. Then this gives an isomorphic between them. So there is no contradiction between the toric geometry and this Frank manifold. But there is a continuous story. So toric geometry also tells us that the integer cohomology, okay? The coefficient with an integer. And this is also same with an same formula is an above. is a polynomial ring with an integer coefficient, a quotient by this EDL. So let's think about this kind of things. Actually, between them, yes, maybe it's an exercise. Actually, these two are not isomorphic. Okay. So this means that this formula doesn't give the answer of the integer coefficient. So it's only for a rational coefficient.
So the left-hand side, the description by using tau,
yes,
is a standardizing description.
Ah, yes, that's right. And actually, tau is a divisor. The CP1.
And the right-hand side is the GKM.
No. Actually, GKM is kind of the left-hand side, I think. Yeah, right-hand side is coming from the, how should I say, it's an fiber bundle structure or something. It's an another story to get it. And actually, this is an open question. I think. So can I erase this? Yeah. Where write this? But I still don't know this is exactly open question or not. But I didn't know the literature about this. What is the formula? Well, this equivalent cohomology. With integer coefficient, okay. So actually, with rational coefficient is already known by the Borel, but in integer coefficient, in some cases is already known. So as you know, the Schubert calculus person knows well about the integer coefficient and the classical types, and some part is an exceptional types. So the maybe good reference is an maybe Nakagawa's video in a Kais Schubert. Curious. Lecture video. in Kais archive, I think. Nakawa has talked about the equivalent Schubert calculus, and equivalent Schubert calculus gives some of the partial answers to this question. Maybe I can say one more example. This is very similar result, similar space with the previous one. So let's think about G equals U2 and T equals T2. Then G over T is the same space with the previous one. And in this case, we think about T2 acts on CP1. And also, Y group is an symmetric group. And in this case, H star BU2 is nothing but S2 invariant part of the QU1 U2, because this is a two-dimensional torus and its cohomology ring is a polynomial ring generated by two elements. And actually, in this case, as I said before, this is generated by the symmetric polynomials. Okay, so this is one as the first symmetric polynomial. This is the second symmetric polynomial. Okay. Actually, it's true. I will denote it like that previously. Let's say S2 as an 1 and sigma. Then in this case, sigma acts on U1 to U2 by the permutation of the U1 and U2. Okay? So then this U1 plus U2 doesn't change by these sigma actions, because it just changed the U1 and U2. And U2 plus U1 is the same as the U1 plus U2. But also U1 times U2 doesn't change, because this is just change the order of the multiple. And actually, this is an abelian commutative ring. So this is the same as the U1, U2. And these two invariant part is a generated, exactly generator of the invariant polynomials. OK, so let's compute in this case. Now, by the previous theorem, this equivariant cohomology is nothing but this polynomial divided by the EDL. Now it's n equal 2, so there are four generators like this, and the relation is something like this. The first one is an generated by this part, the first symmetric polynomial, elementary symmetric polynomial. So it means that x1 plus x2 minus y1 tilde plus y2 tilde. Okay. Please recall it. This is first part is generated by the first symmetric polynomial, the difference of the first symmetric polynomial. And the second part is the difference of the second symmetric polynomial. So it means that x1, x2 minus y1 tilde, y2 tilde. Okay. So also in this case, if we put x1, x2 equals 0, then it obtains this kind of ring, y1, y2, divided by, now x1, x2 are 0, so y1 plus y2, and y1, y2. And actually, y1 plus y2 is 0. This is the same reason y1 equal minus y2. So this is isomorphic to qy divided by y squared. And this is nothing but the cohomology, ordinary cohomology of CP1. Okay?
The difference is you have the same phase space, but with the first one is only T1 action.
Right.
The second one has
T2 action.
CP1, but with two.
Yes. Actually, there is a trivial part, but we can also compute contain the trivial part by using this formula.
But trivial. So you have a trivial torus section,
right?
And that equivariant cohomology does not give you this. I mean,
actually,
so can you reduce this to?
Yes, actually, there is some of the split into like this. Yes. T2.
Oh, T1, okay.
Yes, it's BT1.
So, So the BT1 is a trivial part.
Yes, that's right. Okay, let's give a sketch of the proof of the theorem of the Borel. So to compute it, we need an ordinary cohomology of the G over T. So first, we will compute the ordinary cohomology of the G over T. So actually, this is today's main goal. We will use the following lemma. H star G over T is something like this. QY1 to, okay. So let's say. Let this R be a QY1 to YN. So we put the polynomial ring. It's on the polynomial ring as an R. Then this ordinary cohomology ring of the Frag manifold is denoted by like this. So here, this R positive means that it's an ideal generated by positive degrees. Okay. So that is, it accepts the rational part. It's an a coordinate part, not coordinate. It's an the first it's an coefficient part, a constant part. I'm sorry. And this WG is an invariant part of the R positive.
Acting on R.
Yes.
In what way?
In
R is not included at this moment.
Yeah, actually, yes. Each y1 to yn may be regarded as an chunk class of some of the line band over G over T. And WG. Maybe divided, defined by T over T.
So you consider Q of Y1 to Yn as BT, cohomology of BT, or?
All right, cohomology of BT.
And NGT quotient T is acting on T. So that's how we get this section.
Ah, yes, that's right. It's an actually in this proof I didn't use this fact, but I will denote this. It's rho I is an Tn to an it's an ice coordinate net projection. exception. And now by these projections, Tn acts on this C rho I. C rho I means that acts on C. Then we may regard this C as an Tn representation space by the rho I representations. Then this gives some of the, I should say, sorry. Now, as I said before, T acts on G freely. So this gives some of the fiber bundle structure. And its fiber is just on the C. So this gives a vector bundle, okay? Complex one-dimensional vector bundle. Then we can take its first chunk class. Then this is nothing but yi, this yi. And actually, this is now. Actually, we can define it on an integer coefficient. But in this proof, I didn't use this kind of fact. I just used a fiber bundle structure of the following kind of things. So before that, let's recall the following theorem. This is an Bott-Samuelson. Now this Flagg manifold, this is a well-known topological space. This has an only even dimensional cells. Only even cells. Okay, so there is no odd dimensional cells. So this is the first key fact to prove this. Without this kind of chunk classes. So as an conclusion of this theorem, we see that so this odd dimensional cohomology is vanished. Okay? And moreover, we've already computed H star PC. This is computed by the wild group invariant part of the polynomial ring. But because H star PC, this is nothing but the wild group invariant part, okay? And this H sub Btn is nothing but an ux1, say x1 to xn, w of g. So actually, this is a degree 2 elements. So this says that odd degree cohomology of Bc is also vanished, okay? So these two statements says that the following things. Moreover, I will put that. Okay. So BG is an simply connected. So this is because now we assume G is compact. Compact and connected. So connected is important. So we can get this exact sequence. So okay, this one. Pi 1g pi 1 bg pi 1 bg pi 0 g is something like this. Okay, so now this is 0 and this is this is yes because it's a contractible and this is 1. Yes, that's right. this is isomorphic to the 1. So pi 1, I'm sorry, this is
not 1, but that's
yes.
They're 2 isomorphic, pi 0, pi 0, EG and pi
0. That's right, I'm sorry, yes, this is isomorphic, so this is also 0. So it's a simply connected, sorry, thank you. This is called an homotopy exact sequence. This is obtained by this fiber bundle structure. Okay. So this gives the following things. Therefore, these two statements say that the cell spectral sequence of this vibration, this vibration is often appears. Okay. So this is PT. PT may be regarded as PC over T. And this PC may be regarded as PC over T. And this pull back is a G over T. Okay. It's collapsing.
Not EG.
Thank you. EG. EG, right. It's collapsing on E2 term. So what did this mean? Actually, I didn't say the detail about the cell spectral sequence, but cell proves the following things. For the fiber bundle, it's on the fiber bundle, and this is a simply connected, we assume. There is some systems which is denoted by ER and DR, and DR is called a differential, and ER is a sum of the algebra, such that it's a module. This DR is defined between, and now this ER is a bi-graded module, and it's graded by P and Q, so R is fixed, and DR is defined, this P goes to plus R, and Q goes to minus R plus 1. So it means that it's R minus 1 down, okay? So this is the first differential. And now you take two differential, then is it equal to 0? So it means that we can take an cohomology of ER, PQ, and DR. Actually, it's bi-graded. And this is nothing but the next part of this system. So in other words, ER plus 1 is defined by this cohomology. Okay, so it's inductively defined by from the, usually it's E2 term. Why E2 term? Because E2 term is defined by this way. HP P HQ FQ. Okay, so it's in a cohomology of the P with this coefficient. So in this case, this is nothing but, because it's on a Q coefficient, PQ tensor QN over Q. Okay? So this is called an cell spectral sequence. And more important thing is, now we can take this kind of cohomology inductively and infinitely many. Then this cohomology is convergence to the cohomology of this part. Okay. So this is a theorem, fundamental theorem. And E2 term means that E2, this part, and collapsing means that this D2 is zero. Okay, so if this D2 is zero, then all of the other ER is isomorphic to the E2. Okay, so it means that this E2 is isomorphic to the, this cohomology ring of the X. So let's little bit check it. So in our case, now order degree PC is zero, and order degree G over T is zero. Both of them are fiber bundle of the previous fiber. Yes, this fiber. This one. Then E2 term is something like this. This is an E2 term. Now P is an generated by the base space, right? This is a base space. So in this case, base space is PG. Here, this PG. Okay, let's look at this. So this line is an this degree of the PG, and this line is degree of the G over T. And it's ordering like this. Zero, one, two, three, four, something like this. Zero, one, two, three, four, something like this. Now, this says that order degree part, something like this. This part, for example, this part and this part. And this part as well, and this part as well. All of them are zero, because ordering cohomology is zero. In this case, maybe you can easily check that it's just a tensor, and order degree is a zero, so it's a tensor Q is a zero, exactly zero. Okay? And let's consider this D2. So collapsing on E2 means that all of the D2 is zero. So for example, it takes from this kind of coordinate, it's nothing because it's already zero. So let's take, for example, from this. This might not be zero. But this D2 is defined by something like this. Now this P direction goes to the 2. Okay, so 2 block, something like this. And this Q direction goes down to the R minus 1 block. So in this case, it's 1 block. And 1 block, then it becomes zero. Okay. So it means that this D2 is zero. Actually, all of the D2 is zero. So it means that so this E2, this cohomology ring, is isomorphic to the E3. And of course, this is a zero. So this is an isomorphic to. So it's finally it's an isomorphic to the PT. Okay. And now this E2, in our case, this is nothing but the it's the G over T. And times H star PG, okay? In the tensor Q, okay? So therefore we know that this one is not already time. Therefore, we see that this H star PT is isomorphic to the H star G over T. Times is a tensor H star PG. Okay? And we need to note that actually this isomorphism is just an additive isomorphism. Actually, cell spectral sequence doesn't say anything about the ring structures. It just says additive, a module structure is an isomorphic. But we know that ring structure of the H star PT by using this additive structure. Because now there is this vibration, and let's say this is I and pi. Now there is this map from H star PT to the H star G over T. Induced by this I star, okay? I-star induces this map. Actually, this is a ring isomorphism, a ring homomorphism. And moreover, this additive structure says that this ring homomorphism is just a projection onto this part, this coordinate. So it means that the kernel of this I star is nothing but a positive part of this H star BG. Okay? So it means that this is nothing but the quotient by the positive part of the BG. And now this BG was, we've already computed it. It's an invariant by the WG action. And the positive part is nothing but an ideal generated by the positive. So it means that this is nothing but, this is just an R. So this is nothing but R quotient RWG positive. Okay, so that's all. So actually, there is a geometric meaning on each element. But we do not need such kind of geometric meaning by using this way. Yeah, actually, day after tomorrow, I will also talk about the geometric meaning about these elements and give a proof of the equivalent cohomology. OK, I'll stop here today. Thank you.